Good morning. Let us start today's session, that is session 5 on introduction to active filters. In the previous classes, we have spoken about data converters, digital to analog and analog to digital converters, and precision rectifiers, half wave and full wave. In today's class, we'll be talking about active filters. Generally, filters are those circuits which pass on a certain frequency range of a given input signal to the output and attenuate the remaining frequencies. So, what frequency should be passed? That will be specified in the design. A filter circuit can be designed accordingly. Therefore, outcomes of today's session, you'll be able to understand what are active filters and classify the filters. You'll also be able to identify and understand the various terms used with respect to active filters, like the various bands, pass band, stop band, transition band, or attenuation band, the terms like order of a filter, the roll-off rate of a filter, its cutoff frequency, bandwidth of a filter. So there are a variety of terms used with respect to filters. All those things we are going to understand and study today, along with the classification of filters. Filters are those circuits which select certain portions of the input signal frequencies and allow them to move on to the output, and they disable certain frequencies in the input signal to pass on to the output. So we can also call filters as frequency selective circuits. Okay. And coming to the basic classification of filters. So we call these filters as signal filters. These signal filters can be of two basic types. They can be analog or digital filters. So if you use an analog filter, it will filter the analog signals or continuous wave signals, especially some frequency components, as I told you, will be passed on to the output. Some will be attenuated. And digital filters will tend to attenuate or pass on signals, digital signals. And coming to analog filters, here we are talking of analog filters here because we are using linear ICs. The linear ICs are also known as analog ICs. They work with analog signals. So all the filters which we discuss here are analog filters. We can have element type analog filter, or you can have another classification based on the band of frequency which is allowed or deterred, which frequency is allowed, which frequency is stopped. Okay, so based on the type of elements used in the filter, if I design a filter using only active components along with passive components, in the sense I use transistors, op amps, along with resistors and capacitors, we call them as active filters. If I use only passive components like R, L, or C, that is resistor, capacitor, or inductor, then we call it as a passive filter. Okay. So based on the type of elements used, filters can be classified as active and or passive. Here we'll be talking about active filters. Next, coming to the band of frequencies which is passed and which is attenuated. So we can have basically five types. You see, there are five types of filters based on the frequency band which is allowed and whichever is attenuated. So basically, we think of which frequency band is allowed to pass from input side to the output side, or the signal existing in that given frequency band will be allowed to pass from input to output. You have low pass filters. Low pass means it will pass on the signal at low frequencies. it attenuates the signal at high frequencies. Okay. Next is high pass. A high pass filter will do the opposite job. So if my x-axis is frequency and y-axis is gain. So gain versus frequency. It will attenuate the signal at low frequencies and it will allow the signal to pass on at high frequencies. This is called a high pass filter. Next is a band pass filter. As the name indicates, it allows certain band of frequencies to pass through and it will attenuate the signal before that band and even after that band. So signals within a given bandwidth, say between F1 and F2, signals within that exist within that given bandwidth are passed on to the output, and anything before that frequency F1, they are attenuated. Anything after F2, they are again attenuated. Okay. So this is about band pass filters. Then we have band reject filters. The band reject filters, as the name indicates, will reject a certain band of frequencies and it will pass all the rest. So you see the characteristics will look something like this. The frequency response characteristic of a band reject filter will look like this. It will be allowing the signals at low frequencies. It will start rejecting the signal at some particular frequency F1, and it keeps rejecting till another frequency F2. You see, rejecting means the signal is not passed. It is almost zero. The gain is zero. And after F2, it will again allow the signal to pass through. The frequencies in the signal which are above F2 will again be allowed to pass through and reach the output. So this is about a band reject filter. And we also have an all pass filter. What do you think is an all pass filter? It is a circuit which passes all the input signal frequencies to the output. So if you have an all pass filter, it passes all the frequencies of the input signal to the output. And this is called all pass filter. Can somebody tell me what is the need of such a filter? How do you call it a filter if it passes all the signals? A filter is a network which will allow some frequencies and it will attenuate some more frequencies, right? So then why do you call a circuit which sends the complete input signal, all frequencies in the input signal to the output? Why should you call it a filter then? It's a simple reason. This all pass filter will introduce a phase change in the signal. It introduces phase change in the input signal and passes all the frequencies. Hence, this circuit is helpful in some communication receivers. Like we use a concept known as equalizer. So there will be phase differences between the signals received in the direct path and those signals which get reflected from the sky, from the ground. So there are many signals reaching the receiver and there will be phase difference between those signals. And such things can be avoided and we can get a proper reception, a good quality reception, if we use something known as an equalizer, where the concept of phase shift comes into picture. So such all pass filters are circuits that can be used in equalizers and many other applications. Okay. So basically it won't filter any part of the input signal frequency, but it will introduce phase shifts to different input signal frequencies. Anyway, we'll be studying only the low pass, high pass, band pass and band reject filters in our studies for this time. And along with this classification, when we come to band pass and band reject, which will pass a band of frequencies or reject a band of frequencies, we can also have narrow and wide band pass and band reject filters. So among band pass and band reject filters, you can have either narrow or wide. Narrow means which allows, or let me take a band pass filter. A narrow band pass filter will allow only a small band of input signal frequency to pass through to the output. So it can be as small as a single frequency. Okay. So whenever a band pass filter has a narrow bandwidth, it will allow only a small band of input signal frequencies to reach the output. We call it as a narrow band pass filter. Whereas if the band pass filter has a wide bandwidth, it allows a large band of frequencies in the input signal to pass on to the output. It's a wide band pass filter. The same thing can be applicable to band reject filters also. I hope you understood the classification of filters. So as I have already defined, filters are circuits which are capable of passing signals within a given range of frequencies while rejecting or blocking signals of frequencies outside that range or outside that band. So this property of filters is known as frequency selectivity. I already told you passive filters are built using just RLC components. Active filters will make use of transistors or op amps along with RL and C. And then we have active filters are more commonly used than passive filters because we can introduce a gain in active filters. Remember, using active components, I can amplify signals. So whenever I want not only filtering, but also amplification, you want both filtering and amplification, then you can make use of active filters. They are more commonly used in applications than the passive filters. And they are also employed in a wide range of applications like entertainment, medical electronics, so on. Now, as I already mentioned, see, an original signal can be a complicated or a complex signal. Such a signal is said to have multiple frequencies. It can have a range of frequencies. So many frequency signals are added to generate such a complex signal. Okay. And see, for example, this signal is made up of this frequency component. Let me consider this frequency component is 100 Hertz. The second frequency component is, for example, 200 Hertz. This third frequency component is 300 Hertz, so on. So I have added three different frequency components to make up this complex signal. Okay. Breaking up a given signal into its composite frequencies is done by using a mathematical procedure known as what? Fourier series. You are familiar with Fourier series, right? You have studied. So Fourier series is expressing any given waveform in the form of sum of sines and cosines. So writing a Fourier series for a signal is to write any complicated waveform as a sum of sines and cosines along with a DC signal. We can use Fourier transforms also to do a similar job. So we have certain conditions to be satisfied if we have to apply them. So if the given signal satisfies those conditions, we call them as Dirichlet's condition. You should be familiar with those. Anyway, if at all it is satisfied, then you can show this breaking up of any signal. Whatever signal you have, a square wave will also be made up of sine waves, sum of sine waves. So any wave shape can be expressed as a sum of sinusoidal signals. So that's the easy way to analyze. Okay. So if I have a complex signal with so many frequency components, if it is fed as input to a low pass filter, the output will pass on only the lower frequency. So depending upon whatever is the cutoff frequency which I set up, see, this is the transfer function, or this is the spectrum, the frequency spectrum of the low pass filter. As you can see, it will pass on the signal until a particular frequency FC, and after that we'll say it is attenuating the signal. So among all these three frequencies, if I send the signal through a low pass filter, only the lowest frequency here will pass through that. Is that clear? That's how the output will be. The low frequency signal will pass through with proper amplitude. The high frequency signals will get attenuated. So the high frequency signals would get attenuated and the low frequency signals will pass through. Similarly, if the same complex signal is passed through a high pass filter, what would happen? The high frequency signal, which is the highest among the three. So if I set up again a cutoff frequency as, let me say, FL, I'll call the cutoff frequency of this filter as FL. That means any frequency which is present in the input signal above FL, that frequency will be passed on to the output. So you have set the threshold value as a given frequency FL. Say I have set the threshold value FL as, for example, 250 Hertz. So in the input signal, there are three frequency components. One is 100, one is 200, the other is 300. So which signal will pass through? The 300 Hertz signal will pass through the high frequency, high pass filter with gain as it is, with amplitude as provided, whereas the other two signals will get blocked or attenuated. So the amplitude of the other two frequency components will reduce, whereas the amplitude of the high frequency component will be maintained. And I can, if I use an active high pass filter, I can even amplify this 300 Hertz signal and pass it, and I can attenuate these two 100 or 200 Hertz signal. So high pass filter, as you see, has this kind of frequency response, blocks the signals at low frequencies, allows the signal to pass through at high frequencies. Now, if I have a band pass filter, which I'll select the range of frequencies, say it should pass the signals between 175 and, let me say, 225 Hertz. So I'll set two frequency limits. Since it is a band pass filter, it needs a lower frequency limit and a higher frequency limit. Once you set those two limits, coming to the input signal, among the three frequency components present in the input signal, only the signal which lies within this band, the frequency component which lies above 175 and below 225 Hertz, will be allowed to the output. So here it will be the 200 Hertz signal which will be available at the output of this band pass filter. Okay. Hope this is clear to you. Finally, coming to the band reject filter. This band reject filter, if it is going to have very narrow bandwidth, then we are going to call it as a notch filter. See, the notch filter characteristics will be something like this. In the sense, it will allow signals to pass until it reaches one particular frequency, a single a particular frequency known as the notch frequency will get rejected, and again the rest of the frequencies will be passed through. So you will see that it will make the characteristics resembling a notch in any place. So you poke some needle and pull it out, it will make a notch. So that kind of notch shape is obtained as the spectrum of a narrow band reject filter, which can reject a single frequency or a very narrow bandwidth of frequencies. So in this example, we have considered the bandwidth to be in such a way that it should reject the signal which is present between 175 and 225. I'll take the same values as in the band pass. So whatever is the signal between 175 and 225 hertz, it should reject. So you will see what will happen at the output of this notch filter. The 100 hertz signal will pass on to the output, and the 300 hertz signal will be passing on to the output. Only the 200 hertz signal will get rejected. It won't be available at the output. So I hope this clarifies the concept of filters and how they work. Low pass, high pass, and band reject. Next, coming to certain terminologies used in filters. Say I have shown the frequency response of the filter. So this corresponds to the frequency response of an active filter. As you can see, we have plotted gain here in decibels. In the y-axis, we have plotted gain in decibels, and in the x-axis, we have plotted frequency in decades. Or let's see, you see the points marked 0.01 FC, 0.1 FC. There is a difference of 10. So there is a factor of 10 difference between this first one and the second marked frequency. Again, between the second and third, there is again a multiplication factor of 10 involved. So we say this difference to be one decade. We have already discussed about what is one decade. One decade is a difference in frequency by a factor of 10. Say from 100 hertz to 1 kilohertz, it is one decade of frequencies. Likewise, from FC to 10 FC, it is one decade. From 10 FC to 100 FC, it is one decade. Or from 0.1 FC to FC, it is again one decade. So whenever there is a factor of 10 difference between two frequencies, we call it as a decade of frequencies. And usually we will measure something known as roll-off of a filter in decibels per decade. It is the slope at which the gain of the filter reduces or increases. Okay. Anyway, coming to ideal filter, an ideal filter will have the response like this. An ideal low pass filter will give you the response something like this. In the sense, it will allow signals to pass through from 0 to FC, and at FC, it should stop allowing the signals, and any input frequency after FC, it should completely block. So this is the ideal characteristic of a low pass filter. But please remember, practically no filter can have this kind of sudden change. Such a sudden change is not possible in any practical filter. Therefore, what should we do? We have to consider what happens in a practical filter. It will be a gradual change. Instead of this sudden change, you will notice a gradual change happening from the pass band. The region where the signal is allowed to pass is called pass band, and the region where the signal is completely attenuated is called stop band. So this is stop band and this is pass band. Okay. In an ideal filter, I have a rectangular pass band and a stop band which is at zero. And the transition from pass band to stop band happens suddenly. Whereas for a practical filter, the transition from pass band to stop band, here, this region is called the stop band. Okay. And this region is the pass band. And the change or transition from pass band to stop band is called the transition band, or this is also called the roll off of the filter. This is also called the transition band, where the gain changes from maximum value to minimum value. In a filter, whatever is the maximum value of gain you will be getting, from that maximum to minimum value, the gain would be changing, and that will happen within the transition band. Okay. And the rate of change of gain the rate of change of gain in the transition band per decade, rate of change of gain per decade of frequencies. So x-axis is in decades and y-axis is in decibels. So for example, let me consider here, this is 10 FC and this point corresponds to 100 FC. So if I try to find the slope, if I try to measure the slope of this transition curve for one decade of frequency change. So it from 10 FC to 100 FC, there is one decade of change in frequencies. And correspondingly, what will be the change in gain? For one decade change in frequencies, the change in gain is approximately 20 dB. You see, it is changing from minus 20 to minus 40. So there is a change of approximately minus 20 decibels from this point to this point, which is defined as the slope of this transition band for one decade of frequencies. So that is also known as the roll-off rate of a filter. So roll-off rate is change in gain in decibels divided by what? Change in frequency by one decade. So always remember the definition. Roll-off rate represents the change in gain. So gain change from one point to another point in dB divided by one decade change in frequency. So when the frequency changes by one decade, by how much the gain changes, that is called the roll-off rate. The rate at which the gain is rolling off or falling off, that is called the roll-off rate. Okay. And remember, this roll-off rate will vary based on something known as the order of a filter. Anyway, we'll come to that a little later. Now, coming to these characteristics, this point, which is 3 decibels less than the maximum value. See here, the maximum value is 0 decibels. The maximum value of gain is 0 decibels. And this point corresponds to minus 3 dB. It is 3 dB less than the maximum. That point is called your cutoff frequency and it will be a measure of the bandwidth. So if I have to measure the bandwidth of this low pass filter, I'll measure from this end where the frequency is 0.01 FC to FC. So the pass band region, the region where the given signal is passed on without any attenuation to the output side, that is your pass band. And to identify what is the frequency bandwidth of this pass band, you start off with zero because low pass filter starts passing signals even at zero frequencies. That's why it's low pass. It allows signals from zero frequency until some cutoff frequency FC. And that cutoff frequency is defined as the 3 dB point. It is 3 dB less than the maximum gain. Okay. Actually, we studied all this in module 2 when we spoke about the frequency response of a common source amplifier. Anyway, so this is also called as critical frequency sometimes. The cutoff frequency or critical frequency, you can see, it is specified as the point where the response drops by 3 decibels from the passband value, or it will be around 70.7% of the passband response. So the gain here will be around 70.7% of the passband. Hope you understood what is passband, what is stop band, what is transition band. What do you mean by roll-off rate? What is one decade? All that. If you have any doubts, you can always ask. Feel free to interrupt and ask. We have already discussed these characteristics. These are the characteristics of practical filters. You have a low-pass filter passing signals at low frequencies and it will start attenuating signals at high frequencies. So the pass band will vary from 0 to this FC, and the stop band will vary from FC to FS. Similarly, this critical frequency or cutoff frequency is the point which is 3 decibels less than the highest gain. And high pass filter attenuates low frequencies, passes on signals at high frequencies. Similar thing, band pass allows signals between F1 and F2 frequencies to pass on with sufficient gain, whereas the other signals are attenuated. So stop band, pass band, stop band. So band pass filter will have two stop bands and one pass band. The bandwidth of the pass band is what is useful for us in our designs. Finally, the band reject filter or the notch filter. See, notch filter is a narrow band reject filter usually. It will try to reject a given range of frequencies or band of frequencies from F1 to F2. We have defined the lower cutoff as F1, higher cutoff as F2. So if you can reject all frequencies from F1 to F2, it is known as a band reject filter. Next, coming to the order of a filter, we already discussed a role of. So we were talking about the order of a filter, and we spoke about what is a first order filter. If the transfer function, so if the transfer function of the filter is in the form something like this, A naught by S plus omega naught, transfer function means it is the ratio of output to input, then if I have S to the power of 1, it is a first order filter. Okay. And if I have the transfer function in the form S square plus something like this plus omega naught square something, or it is something like this, A naught by S minus omega 1 into S minus omega 2. So I have S square surely. So if it is either in this form in the denominator or in the form of the product of two S functions, then it is a second order filter. And if I have something like A naught by S cubed plus something plus omega cubed or omega naught cubed, then it is a third order filter. Or the other way of writing a third order filter is what? A naught by S minus omega 1, S minus omega 2, S minus omega 3. So you remember this kind of transfer function we had got in the common source frequency response. The low frequency response of a common source amplifier, we had a similar transfer function. So this is a third order filter. The order of the filter will also decide the roll-off rate of the filter. You see here, in the first example here, in this curve 1, this change in gain is from minus 20 to minus 40 when the change in frequency happens to be from 10 to 100. So for one decade change in frequency, the change in gain is minus 20 decibels. So the roll-off rate of a first order filter will be minus 20 decibels per decade if it is a low pass filter. If it is a high pass filter, it will be plus 20 dB because it will be increasing. Similarly, you can see the curve blue color line for a second order filter. In this blue color line, if you notice, observe from this point to this point, it is what? One decade of frequency. So one decade change of frequency is from here to here. And in that one decade change of frequency, by how much has the gain changed? Gain has changed from minus 40 to minus 80. So the gain has changed by
40 decibels for one decade of frequency. Hence, you can clearly observe that the roll-off rate of a second order filter will be 40 decibels per decade. Okay, minus and plus, you leave it. If it is decreasing, it is minus. If it is increasing, it is plus. Okay, for low pass, it will be minus usually. For high pass, it will be plus. Similarly, you can see this green line, which is for a third order filter. And if I have to measure one decade of frequencies here, I should start from somewhere here and end up here. You see from here to here, there is almost 20, 40, 60. 60 decibel change of gain. Three boxes you can see for one decade of frequency. So I have one decade of frequency change and I have 60 decibels change of gain in this green line. You see the roll-off rate is faster. The slope is higher. It is falling faster. At a faster rate, the gain is falling from maximum to minimum. Hence, you have higher roll-off rates for a third order. Similarly, the fourth order, it will be 80 decibels per decade. For fifth order, it will be 100 decibels per decade. You can see this fifth order is this purple line. If you start from this point where it is 0 dB, you are ending within one decade. So from 1 to 10 hertz, within one decade change of frequency, gain has changed from 0 dB to minus 100 dB. So it will be 100 decibel per decade will be the roll-off rate for a fifth order filter. So please understand this clearly. The order of a filter will basically be decided by the power of the Laplacian variable S in the V0 to VI ratio, also called as transfer function of the filter. If that power of S is 1, it will make a first order filter. And if that power is 2, it will be a second order filter. If it is 3, it will be third order. Another way of writing second order is as a product of two poles, S minus omega 1 into S minus omega 2. Okay. And one more thing to remember is the roll-off rate will be minus, it will be 20 decibels per decade in a first order, 40 decibels per decade in second, 60 decibels per decade in third order, so on. And another way to differentiate between the order of the filter is based on the number of RC circuits used. If we are using an RC filter, if I have one RC section, if I have a single RC section, it will normally be a first order filter. If I have two RC sections, it will be a second order. But this is not the fixed way of defining. It is generally true, but need not be true always. Okay. So there are filters with just two RC sections, but which can work like third order, so on. So usually this is true, but it can't be generalized. So the best way of defining the order of a filter is based on the power of S in the denominator of the transfer function. If I have a power of S as 5, it will be a fifth order filter. And one more thing which you can notice, the higher the order of the filter, the roll-off rate is much faster. And it will come much closer to the behavior of an ideal filter. Remember, ideal filter, the roll-off should change. It should be sudden. It should be high. It should suddenly come to low. It should be a sudden change. So for order 5, you see it has come. There is a huge change in gain for a very less change in frequency. So it will come closer and closer to that of an ideal filter if I go on increasing the order of the filter. Okay. So if the order of the filter is very high, that filter will be very close to that of an ideal filter. And in ideal filter, this roll-off rate is how much? It changes by maximum amount within zero frequency. Very small frequency, but the change in gain is maximum. So you're dividing something with zero, so this roll-off rate will become infinite for an ideal filter. Remember that. Okay, so the roll-off rate is infinity for an ideal filter, whereas it will come closer and closer to ideal filter if I'm going to increase the order of a filter. So if you go on increasing the order of the filter, you can increase the roll-off rate. Anyway, what are the advantages of active filters? We'll just finish this and stop. Tomorrow we'll continue with the low-pass filter. Active filters can be designed to provide required gain and hence no attenuation like in passive filters. In passive filters, what happens? If the input signal amplitude is 1 volt, I'll get the output signal amplitude to be maximum 1 or less than 1. I may get 0.9 volts or so, because all the passive components which we use inside will tend to absorb energy. It will tend to reduce energy. So you will be getting output less than or equal to the input. Whereas if I use an active filter, I can get output more than input. A gain can be designed. There won't be any loading problem in active filters because usually we have high input resistance of the op amp. Since we are going to use op amps or transistors, they have high input impedance. Hence, loading problem will never occur in active filters, but in passive filters, it will always be there. If I have one RC section, if I'm going to get the output amplitude of 0.9 volts, if I use two RC sections in series, I'll get the output amplitude only 0.7 volts. That's because each RC section is attenuating. Okay. So in passive filters, there will be loading effect which causes attenuation. Active filters are also cost effective as a wide variety of economic op amps are available. So one op amp IC will cost not even 1 rupee. Sometimes you get it at less, 5 rupees, less than that, depending on the type. So very cost effective op amps are available, and hence use of active filters is important. So I think we'll stop with this today. We'll continue with the low pass filter and its design in the next class.
Therefore, coming to the summary of today's class, in this session, you learned to understand and classify active filters, various classes of filters or types of filters, different classifications we studied based on the elements used, active, passive, based on their frequency response, low pass, high pass, band reject, all pass, so on. We also understood various terms associated with active filters, like the pass band, stop band, transition band, and order of a filter, roll off of a filter, so on. Let's try to understand how much we have understood in today's class by taking up this simple quiz. So quickly we'll go through this short quiz. A dash filter rejects all frequencies within a specified band and passes all those outside this band. So what would it be? Understand the question correctly. Sorry. Here you can see it rejects all frequencies in a given band and passes all those outside the band. So naturally it should be a band stop filter, as you can see. The second question is, identify the frequency response curve of a band pass filter. These are the four curves which are given. You can clearly see band pass filter should be opposite that of band stop, which we saw in the last question. So your answer should be the first one, A. The third question, a dash filter significantly attenuates all frequencies below FC, the cutoff or critical frequency, and passes all frequencies above FC. If you try to translate this question into a waveform or in the frequency response, you'll clearly understand. It will attenuate all frequencies. So there is a frequency FC. It will attenuate all frequencies below FC. In the sense, it should be like this. It should attenuate below FC and it should pass all frequencies above FC. So as you can see, it should be a high pass filter. The next, the bandwidth in a dash filter equals the critical frequency. A little tricky. So in which filter do we have bandwidth same as the critical frequency? Say if this is the critical frequency, if bandwidth and critical frequency should be the same, naturally this should be a low pass filter. So here something here, the critical frequency will come. So in a low pass filter, you see, this should be 3 dB less than the maximum, right? Pass band. The bandwidth of this filter will be FC minus 0. So your answer is low pass. Next, the critical frequency is defined as the point at which the response drops dash from the pass band. Just now we saw in the previous case, the critical frequency will be defined as that point where the response drops by how much? Minus 3 dB from the pass band. So the answer should be minus 3 dB. It's also known as the half power point, because at this point, the power will be half of the maximum value or the passband value. And also at this point, the overall gain would be 70.7% of the maximum value. Moving on to the next question, third order filter will have a roll-off rate of, first thing you should notice, it's a third order filter. So naturally the transfer function V0 by VI, as I told you, will have three poles, S minus omega 1, S minus omega 2, S minus omega 3, or it can be written as A0 by S cube plus something plus omega cube, right? So it could be written either like this or like this. So what do you notice? It should have S to the power of 3 in the denominator, or it should have three poles like this. And per pole, the change in gain will be 20 decibels per decade. So 20 plus 20 plus 20 with three poles. So total change I'm going to have is 60 dB. And since all are given as negative and they haven't mentioned which filter it is, our right choice will be minus 60 dB per decade. And remember, here it will be per decade, a change in frequency by a factor of 10. In which filter the output and input voltages are equal in amplitude for all frequencies? Which one would that be? Output follows the input. That means the gain is 1 at all frequencies. Output should be same as the input at all frequencies. Naturally, this should be an all-pass filter. So as we have discussed, an all-pass filter passes the input to the output side at all frequencies, but its main usage is it's going to introduce a phase shift between the input and output signals, which can be used for communication equalizer applications. As I told you, it's an all-pass filter. Okay, the gain of the first order low-pass filter. So here we are talking of a low-pass filter. Is this right? No, a low-pass filter should have the frequency response characteristics like this. This is, it passes the signals at low frequencies and it attenuates the signal at high frequencies. So it is talking about what will happen to the gain. And I think since they are talking about increasing and decreasing, that should happen in the transition band. So in the transition band, it will decrease for a low pass filter. So you can cancel out these two where we say it is increasing, because in a low pass filter, the gain is always decreasing. So it should be either C or D. Next, we'll move on to see what is the rate at which it decreases. Here, what else is mentioned in the question? It's told it's a first order low pass. So first order means the decrease should be at a rate of 20 decibels per decade. Remember, first order means just one RC section. So the decreasing rate would be 20 decibels per decade. And for second order, it would be 40. Hence, your answer is C, decreases at the rate of 20 decibels per decade. Coming to the next question, or before this, let me also mention that the change in frequency can happen in by a factor of 2. Say if this is F0, the next point can be at 2F0, the third point can be at 4F0, 8F0, something like this. So whenever there is a change in frequency by a factor of 2, we say it is one octave of change. So whenever the frequency doubles, and we are going to consider the change in frequency from the given to the next point where the frequency has doubled as one octave. Don't mistake oct to represent 8. It is doubling of the frequency. And all these roll-off rates can be given in decibels per octave also. So if it is 20 decibels per decade, usually the equivalent for 20 dB per decade would be 6 dB per octave. So whenever the frequency doubles, the change will be by 6 dB. So we can also represent the x-axis in octaves, but the change in x-axis by a factor of 10 or 1 decade is the more common representation used. Okay, just keep this in mind. Name the filter which has two stop bands. So which filter will have two stop bands? One stop band here and another stop band. You can guess easily. This is the response of a band pass filter. It passes a range of frequencies between F1 and F2, and it will attenuate frequencies on either side of that band. So it should be a band pass filter. Which filter will have two pass bands? So which filter should have two pass bands? Like this. This is one pass band and this is the second pass band. This should be a band reject filter. Remember that. A band reject filter will have two pass bands. A band pass filter will have two stop bands. The last question. Determine the order of filter used when the gain increases at the rate of 100 decibels per decade in the stop band. So stop band here means transition band. Let's say this is transition band, not completely In some books, they call that transition band also as stop band. So what are they telling? They are telling the gain is increasing at the rate of 100 decibels per decade. So this gain increases usually in high pass or band pass, something like that generally. And let's see which filters they have mentioned. They mentioned low pass, high pass, only those. So you can eliminate the low pass ones. We know in low pass the gain decreases. So it should either be high, be third order high pass or fifth order high pass. Okay. How will I determine the order? Remember the order of the filter. First order means the change in the roll off rate will be 20 decibels per decade. Second order, it will be double this, 40 dB per decade. So like this, if I consider 100 dB per decade divide by 20, I'll get the value as 5. So it is clearly understood it should be a fifth order high pass filter. Hope you understood the logic. The answer to this question is fifth order high pass filter. So with this quiz, I hope you were able to clearly bring out the understandings of the introduction to filters, which we have discussed today. Let's continue with the design of low pass and high pass filters in the next class. Thank you.